You've been leading a lot of community discussions about COVID as the director of the Flint Center for Health Equity Solutions and working on the after effects, really, of public health with the Flint water crisis. And then COVID hit. So what was your initial reaction in terms of a crisis in underserved communities, in treatment, really, and now with the vaccine for COVID?
Well, it was sort of felt like trauma on top of trauma. And we talk a lot about communities being resilient. But you do sort of ask the question, how much can one community bear? But the one thing I'll say about Flint is we learned a lot about from the water crisis, about how to respond to crisis and how to recover.
What are the biggest concerns that people are coming to you and talking about when it comes to the vaccine now?
So we talk a lot and emphasize a lot vaccine hesitancy and resistance. And what I'm actually finding in the community is the narrative that people are sharing is a little bit different from the one that's being put forward. Most people are saying things like, I'm not a no, I'm a no for now. I'm a let's wait and see. You know, people, the naming even of this initiative, Operation Warp Speed, what a lot of people heard was corner cutting or skipping steps. And so I think the hesitancy that we're seeing around the vaccine, you know, people just have more questions than they do answers. And now we have a new problem, which is a lot of those people who were a no or a no for now have become a yes. And we have a wait list in Genesee County of over 30,000 people, and the list grows by about 2,000 people a day.
Are people able to sign up where they need to? Are they able to get the information that they need to go to the right place to even get on a list? Or are there barriers there that people are counting that should be taken care of?
There are barriers to people getting on the list, and then there are also some solutions that are being implemented. So originally, much of the sign up was digital, and we know we have a digital divide, so that created some barriers for people. And then there was this conversation to sign up on Mondays between 5 and 6. And of course, when you've got a massive number of people trying to get in on one phone line in a one hour window, a lot of people just simply couldn't get through. Then we've had issues around some of the smaller health offices, small pediatric practices or family medicine practices or physical therapy offices not being having access to the vaccine. We're addressing those gaps, but they are real problems that we and many other counties are dealing with.
I want to get back to the conversation about the trust gap that we know exists between Black communities and white communities. We've seen it even in numbers of people who want to go back to school. We know that Black, Latino, and Asian families are more hesitant to send their children back to school, questioning safety in the schools and in buildings than white families are. And when you have that hesitancy, where would you say the trust has broken down, and how can there start to be some repairing of trust that takes a long time, but you're in a pandemic?
So I think some of the trust and some of the hesitancy is a lot of the schools that are predominantly African-American and Latino were in bad condition before COVID. So if you take an overcrowded classroom and you compound that with an airborne infectious disease, as a parent, I can understand people saying these classrooms were already overcrowded in the first place. We have a lot of schools who have not had the opportunity or the resources to upgrade their ventilation systems. And we know good ventilation is an environmental protective measure against the spread of COVID. So I think what we're seeing is the impact of the pre-existing disparities in the quality of schools, the quality of school buildings, and the gap in resources.
Who are also those community messengers? Who are the voices that we need to enable with the information and so they can help build that trust?
I think it varies by community. It varies by age. But if we look broadly, I think we've underutilized churches. Here in Genesee County, our 3 community COVID testing sites are all located in churches in different parts of the city. Pastors have been a key resource and trusted messenger for people in the community. Why? Because they're already engaged. They already are interacting, not just with people in their congregation, but typically with people in the communities where their churches are located. And many of us have become many experts. I say I might be one of the few trained epidemiologists in the community, but there are lots of mini epidemiologists now who sort of understand what's happening, understand how to prevent spread and transmission. And I think we need to pass the mic to those people. Local health departments also play a critical role. And it's important that we not use one media or medium for getting information to people. Some people need something that they can put in their hands and hold and read. Parents may need things that they can tack up on their refrigerator. You know, so I think using social media, using the press, written media, newsletters for parents, we've got to use multiple forms to get the word to people from trusted messengers.
What are some of the biggest, I guess, maybe fallacies that you're hearing come up over and over again when it comes to the COVID vaccine?
I think one of the big myths is that vaccine hesitancy, specifically in the African-American community, predated COVID. If you actually look at what the data tell us, African-American parents vaccinate their children at the exact same rates that white parents vaccinate their children. There's a slight difference in adult vaccinations, and a big part of that is actually due to health insurance status and other social determinants of health. I think specifically some of the hesitancy that we're seeing around the COVID vaccine in particular is due to more modern day wrongdoings and mistreatment in the medical system. We point to things like Tuskegee, but if you look at the studies, many African-Americans didn't really know about Tuskegee, understand what it fully was. I don't think that's the primary driver of people's hesitancy. I think the way we language this effort, I think the fact that there are other important layers of protection, including government resources like payroll protection for small businesses, where African-American businesses were disproportionately left out of, have raised the red flag for people. And they say, if my health is so important as it relates to the vaccine, why was I not allowed to honor the shelter in place order and provide a payroll protection for my small business? Why was I denied enhanced unemployment? You know, it just doesn't jive because so many other important resources that have been rolled out have not been equitably rolled out for women, for minorities, and other disparate populations. So it falls on deaf ears that now the vaccine is the solution for us.
We've had so many conversations about how COVID has really exacerbated that gap in society. And we know that the state has started the Racial Disparities Task Force around health and around COVID. Do you think that's enough?
Health disparities predated COVID. And we saw in the state of Michigan, we closed the African-American white gap in disparities in COVID cases and deaths within the first 6 months of the pandemic. And those strides have been sustained. So clearly we have the capacity. We can do it. What we had to do and what we have to continue to do is deal with the gaps and the cracks in our system. You know, people don't have fair access and equitable access to a pharmacy. People don't have the same level of access to healthcare facilities to even get the vaccine. We don't have a sufficient data structure to even let us know who's getting what and when and by important demographic characteristics like race and geography and insurance status. And so I think the opportunity that we have is to repair those cracks in the system and start to deal with those inequities. Because if we don't, what's going to happen is we'll come out of this pandemic and we'll still be dealing with the problems that we had that predated COVID.
You can find more at OneDetroitPBS.org or subscribe to our social media channels and sign up for our One Detroit newsletter.